I was reading about this Gibbs phenomenon that we discussed last lecture. If you think about it, we need mathematics in physics mainly to solve equations. We don't use math so much for proving theorem or establishing truth using logic, these kind of things. At the practical level, we really use mathematics to solve equations. Why? Because much of physics is formulated in terms of equation. And we've seen already a lot about linear equation, for instance. We spent several past lectures about equation with linear applications or linear functions. But there's also a lot of non-linear equations in physics, of course, especially if we deal with complicated or non-fundamental things, like, I don't know, fluid dynamics or dynamics of the flock of birds, of chemical reactions, things that are non-fundamental, because fundamental phenomena, they tend to be linear. Maxwell's equations are linear, Schrödinger equation is linear, special relativity is linear, not everything though. General relativity, for instance, are non-linear field equations. And also, if we look at fundamental models, fundamental theory, if we make approximation, then we will typically break the linearity and we will turn into non-linear equations. So non-linear equations are really important. And the basic non-linear equation is one that you already know, you are really familiar with it. This is the quadratic equation that we have solved early on in the lecture. So by now, I hope that you are very familiar with this. It's a solution which we find by completion of the square, if you remember. So it's minus b divided by 2a plus or minus square root of this particular quantity, which is the discriminant. We give it a name because its sign determines the character of the solution, if they are real valued or complex valued. And this is b squared minus 4ac. And we look at this quantity first to know the type of solution that we will get. Of course, there are other types of infinite amount of non-linear equations, a lot of them. Yeah, but the others are already too complicated that actually most people don't know much about them. Yeah, so we would ask a computer to solve them numerically, or we would go to the Wikipedia to remind ourselves of the Ferrari solutions or this kind of thing. But what we really need to know, what is really basic, is this quadratic equation for the non-linear type of equations. And this is fairly simple because this is an equation for one number. X is a number. So even though we are doing algebra, which means that we've got letters for what are our parameters, that they should be numbers that we substitute, what we are solving is really an equation for a number. So here we can make a huge conceptual step by upgrading an equation for a number to an equation for a function. Right? So that would be an equation. Let me give you an example, for instance. This equation. This one, why not? Equal t. So there, I didn't use letters, I could have. But this one, it is not a variable like this one. I don't substitute it by a letter. Letter could be there, yeah. It could be c, a plus ct. So I'm doing arithmetic part of the thing because I decided for some particular case of the variable. But the fact that now we are solving for this object which depends on t, as I change t, I am changing the value of this, what was previously a parameter. So therefore, of course, the number will change. And the number that changes as a function of a parameter, it is a function. So you see that the technical step is very small. Although the conceptual step is large, because now we don't solve for a number, we solve for a function. And the consequence of this, a manifestation of this, would be that now we'll be able to plot our solution. It's not a number, it's a function, so we can plot that. But the technical step is nil. Is infinitesimal, because we are using the same formula, only that one variable now turn into the, sorry, one parameter turn into the variable. So let's do it, let's solve that. We've got two solutions, as before, could be real or valued, complex valued, it depends on the sign of the discriminant. So we've got minus b, which is minus 1, plus or minus divided by 2a, which is 2. The square root of the discriminant, so this thing which will tell me if I've got real valued or complex valued things. So this is 1 minus 4ac. So c, it's this guy which is on the other side, yeah? If we want to have the equation term equal to 0. So this is plus 4t. So you see why, again, we have an equation for a function with which solution is a function. Because this number depends on this parameter that has been upgraded as a variable. So we can plot this, indeed, to convince you fully that we are dealing with an equation for a function, as function of t, which could be time. X of t could be the position of some oscillator as function of time, whatever you want. So what is the solution there? The discriminant will tell us if this is real value or complex value. Let's start with the real value. It will be easier to plot real numbers. So this becomes zero. Of course, the sign changes around zero, so it will become zero when this is zero, which is at t equal minus 1/4. So there, I will, if this is one, at something like there, minus 1/4, we've got our solution will become real when t is larger, because this is positive. And what value is it? Then this is around minus 1/2, which is more or less there. Minus 1/2 is there. Okay, so it will start there. And what is the type of solution? Around this point, minus 1/2, it will be plus or minus square root of this thing. 1 plus 40. So we start at minus 1/2, at 0, 1. So it's something like this. Let's put it in red. Should be something like this, right? Okay, so we could look for this intersection point to be a bit more precise, but I want to go fast, so I will just plot it like this. So this is the real valued solution of this functional equation. We could actually also plot the imaginary and real part to plot the complex things. Yeah. So when t is smaller than, let's do it in green, the real part. When t is smaller than minus 1/4, this will be negative, so I can write it like this. I can write it as I square the negative of this, 1 plus 40, that would give me minus 1 plus 40. Okay, so if this is negative, this thing is positive, I can put this I outside, and I've got this type of solution. Okay, and here I still have minus 1 plus or minus, and divided everybody by 2. So I will divide the 2 there. I will bring this closer to tidy up a little bit. Okay, and remove this, which is not needed. It's just to assure you that this time we picked up the I there, but this is positive, so this is also a square root, like this one. But they open in the other directions, actually. So let's plot two things. Let's plot in green, we'll plot the real part of x. Complex number, it means it has two components. It has a real part and an imaginary part. Both the real and imaginary part, remember, are real themselves, so we can plot them on this plot. So what will be the real part? The real part is minus 1/2, so this is the real part there. Okay, that is a very nice phenomenon, which we see there. It's called the splitting. So this quantity is splitting into, it was 1, that now becomes 2. It's called the splitting. And let's look at the imaginary part. So the imaginary part up to this point, it will be this quantity with the minus in front of the t. So I will plot them in this kind of color. And this is around 0. So it's something like this. Schematically, maybe, but it's something like this. Okay. And when we are passing this threshold, then we will have this quantity which becomes zero, because we are precisely in this region that we solved before when the discriminant was positive. So it becomes negative again, which means it becomes again pure imaginary. So this cancels. So if I do it like this, is this solution. Okay. So this is a very beautiful solution for the quadratic equation for a function this time. Took a particular case, yeah, because we wanted to plot it. And you see these very nice things. We've got at this point, here, at this point, our imaginary part, which were splitted, which were in two, forming two solutions, now they merge into one. And vice versa, the real part, which was one, splits into two. So actually, there is some physics associated to that. This is the physics of the coupled damped oscillator. Remember, we have seen the coupled oscillator, we have seen the damped-driven oscillator. If you couple to damped oscillator, which you can do as well, you have got the technical tools to do it, you will introduce a matrix. This matrix, you will want to diagonalize the problem to reduce your two oscillators into two normal modes or two uncoupled oscillators, and you will solve an equation of this type, and there will be this physics. So this is this physics there, where we've got the splitting of the real part. We call that the physics of strong coupling. This is when the two oscillators dominate, the oscillation dominate the dynamics. And this is the physics of weak coupling, where the dissipation the dissipation dominate the dynamics, which means that the coupling is not playing a role. It doesn't lead to this normal mode like this of the two oscillator. Instead, what happens is that the two oscillator they are like uncoupled because the dissipation is stronger, so it dominates over the coupling. But you see already I'm doing physics and we are supposed to do mathematics. So let's come back to our problem of solving equations of functions. But as I told you, there's almost nothing more to do there, because solving equation of function of this type is like solving equation for numbers, so it's another problem. Indeed, what I want to discuss today, as the topic of this lecture, is when our equation for function involve things like the derivative of the function itself. Yeah? So an equation of this type, for instance. I took x, so now I will use this notation y of x, that's conventional or usual terminology, because we can plot it on, or we can plot our solutions. Remember, if the equation is for a function, we can plot the solution this time, we can plot the curve. So a nice notation or usual notation is this one. The function will be y and the variable will be x. So a typical equation is something like this. Y prime y x is equal to, y of x times x, for instance. This is a so-called differential equation, which involves the function y, its derivative, the function again, and the variable that can be there. Yes? Let me write the general type of differential equation. It's something like this. There is a function of the function, so we don't know what it is, this is left to itself. It involves the variable, the function, the derivative. But why stop at the first order derivative? It could be the second order derivative, the third order derivative, up to the nth order derivative. Remember, we are tired of putting a lot of primes, so we put this little index in parentheses. Is equal to zero. So this f is left so far general. Yeah, it's a function of these things inside. So this we called nth order. So this number here is called the order of the differential equation. And we call that an ordinary differential equation. So D is for differential equation and the O is for ordinary, because we'll see in the last lecture the partial differential equation when we got function of several variables. But for that, we will need to introduce first a multivariable calculus. So let's stick for now for differential equation of functions that have one variable only, ordinary differential equation. Let me give you an example of an equation that you have seen several times before, because it is so important. It involves something which is which has a structure very particular to differentiation, which is the exponential. We said many times, exponential is a very important function. Because the exponential, it has this characteristic. So I said that x is a variable. If you differentiate it, this prime is differentiating for the x variable, then it remains the function itself, which is not the case for most functions. Yeah, if you differentiate a polynomial, you don't keep the function itself. You lower the order of your polynomial. So differentiating a polynomial keeps you a polynomial, but of a different character. In particular, you change the parity if it's a monomial. Yeah, you go from odd to even and vice versa. But the exponential remains itself. So it's a very particular thing, and we will see a bit later on that it helps us to solve some complicated or sophisticated differential equation. So let me show you one differential equation which is very famous. It's called, well, some people like to call it like this snowball equation, because it's a funny name, I suppose. Snowball equation. This is the equation for a snowball. It tells you, that describes the physics of a snowball. If this would be, for instance, so let's take a variable that would describe the type of phenomenon as function of time. So we want to see the surface. I'm not using y of x now. I'm using the surface of the snowball as a function of time. What we describe is the little snowball that is falling on the hill and that is rolls, it acquires, it grows because it catches the snows, right? So yeah, it's a bit bigger because it takes a lot of snow. Something which is intuitive. Maybe not in Britain because we don't have that snow, but I guess well, let me show you on the screen. There you see some people playing with the snowball. You see it grows very fast. Well, don't do what this guy is doing. It could be dangerous. Yeah. So the equation for that is that the surface is proportional. So proportional, it means that it's something like this. Proportional to the rate of growth is proportional to the surface. Yeah. So how much it changed? This is how it changed from t plus delta t minus t divided by delta t. This is the rate of growth. Yeah, definition of a derivative. Send you back to our lectures on infinitesimal. Yeah, so at t it has this size. A little time delta t later, it has this size. It has grown from t to delta t. And what is the rate of change? This is in the limit when delta t goes to zero. It is this derivative, and this is proportional. So it's multiple of the area. Okay, snowball equation. The larger you are, the more snow you get, and the more you grow. Again, this is intuitive. You push the snowball, and you see that very quickly you'll be surprised how it becomes gigantic, and you cannot push it anymore. So this has the solution of the exponential, yeah, because the exponential is this function that if we differentiate, it leaves it to itself. So we can write the solution is exponential a of t. We have the variable that we would put there, and we should check every time we integrate a differential equation, we should check it. So if we take the derivative here, if we take the derivative of this function, we'll get the a goes in front, so it's a, this thing again, which is s of t, so that works. Okay, so at time equals zero, what we get, snowball equation, is this exponential growth. Okay, snowball, it means like this concept of the avalanche, maybe even, the larger it is, the faster it grows. Okay, so exponential growth, it's used maybe for virus propagation, it's used to give this feeling of something that gets very big out of control very quickly, right? In the pandemic, the more people are infected, the more will be infected, because your probability to be infected is proportional to how many people or how spread is the disease already. So that's exponential growth. Let's look at another very famous example, very important example. That's this equation from Newton, F equal ma. If we look at the particular case where F is equal to the gravity, yeah, where G is the gravitational field, the acceleration, the gradient of the gravitational field. So we can cancel the mass. So actually this one is the gravitational mass and this one is the inertial mass. But there is something which you will see level 6 in 2 years time, there is the equivalence principle, weak equivalence principle, which says that the inertial mass is equal to the gravitational mass. So that brings us to this. The acceleration is the rate of change, rate of change, how much it changes per unit time of the speed, v, but the speed is itself the rate of change of the position. So what we get here is the second order derivative of the position. If we are doing vector calculus, I should keep this. Okay, so the equation that we get is x dot dot. We like to use the dot for the time derivative. That's actually Newton's notation, is equal to g. So what is the I could have used y, because x usually we put there, y is the y-axis. Okay, I can do it very quickly, yeah, because then I want to project that on the y-axis, y. Okay, so if we are on the y-axis, we can write this equation like this. I can say that y is yj. Remember, this is normalized vector. Therefore, the equation, if we simplify the j, we've got y dot dot j is equal to gj, and that would be a minus there, if because j is typically like this. And so here I've got this is G and J, okay? Again, from context, you see which one I'm referring to. So we can solve the vector, and we've got the second order derivative is minus G. So same thing, which now we are solving differential equation. This is an equation for a function, because even though I don't write it, there is the time there. Okay, so we want a function that if I take the second order derivative, it is a constant. Which function is that? So there you can use two approaches to solve that. One is the physical intuition. Remember, we are solving the freefall, basically. Yeah, we are solving the question of what is the curve or the shape or the functional dependence on time of something that is in freefall in the gravitational field. And surely you know that. You should know that because you did a lot of mechanics this semester as well. The second is to use your mathematical baggage. Yeah, which function, if I differentiate it twice, would be a constant. This constant, this is 981 meter per second square. Which function is that? So usually it's good to use a bit of both your mathematical knowledge or skill or your intuition, physical intuition, a bit of both. Or maybe you are very strong in physical intuition, maybe you are very strong in mathematical skills. Yeah, different people like to use different recourses. So I don't know which one you you choose, but you certainly have find by now that the solution is a second order polynomial, so variable in T, so it's something like this, where A, B, and C are constant. Yeah, if I take the first order derivative here, I get 2AT plus B, C died. And if I take the second order derivative, which means the derivative of this one, what I get is 2A. Okay, so we will get the solution provided that 2A is equal to minus J. If this is the case, then I can choose B and C freely and it will work. So my solution is actually y of t is equal to minus g divided by 2 t square plus bt plus c. What is b and c then in these things? Should we remove them? Or so again, think in terms of physical intuition. As well, there is something which is really powerful in physics and we should use it as much as we can, is the dimensional analysis. Because this has units, all these things. So that's a meter, that's time. So everything here is in meter. So this is a distance. What is it? At t equals 0, this term cancels. So this is clearly the position of our object at t equals 0. Yeah, that's how, where is it? So that's the height and that's the time. Yeah, so it could be there on top of a cliff or at the bottom of a precipice. Or it could be the apple that is in your hand that you're going to let fall. What is this one? So we said that this needs to be a distance, this is time, so this has to be a velocity. Velocity is what, if you multiply by time, it gives you a distance. Yeah? So what velocity is that? Well, that's the velocity at t equals 0. Yeah? V0t, that's the initial velocity that you give to the object. You have your apple at t equals 0, maybe you are, from this distance, you are throwing the apple, or you are pushing it, yeah? You are giving it an initial velocity. So that's it, that's the solution. We could have done it as well for x of t. For x of t, there is no force on the x direction, so the equation is actually even simpler. What we will get is, you can solve the differential equation, or you can again recourse to your physical intuition. So Galilean intuition, in this case, x will be constant. It will be, so v0x, that would be v0y, t plus x0. That's the solution. And that describes as function of time, that describes the position of your thing. Yeah, so as function of, I will use time, I could use time here as a variable, so that's a parabola. Okay, but also if I plot it as function of the distance in the y-x, so t now is the implicit parameter, which is not apparent on the graph, but you can follow it. It's a parameter. We've got these solutions, yeah, so it's a typical solution. So here there was some velocity, both in x, upward, and that's how the things fall. It's parabola. Yeah? So that's the solutions of Newton, depending on how you throw the thing. So this, again, you know from mechanics. So I'm spending a lot of time on things that you are very familiar because I want to go slowly to start with. Let's look at things that are a bit more general. Yes, so at this equation of this type. Equal... That's a differential equation because that's an equation for functions. It involves the derivative and we've got the parameter. But actually, most people maybe wouldn't call that a differential equation. I don't know, I'm not too sure. It is a differential equation. Huh? But we don't think in terms of the techniques that I will show you for solving differential equation because the solution is fairly straightforward. We'll use the fundamental theorem of calculus, we'll integrate both sides. Yeah? And this is a y of x. That's the fundamental theorem of calculus. So the solution is this one. Is this? I will copy it there. That's the solution. Actually, solving a differential equation, we speak of integrating the equation, which is what we are doing. But here, more than the equation, we are integrating the right-hand side of the equation. So we have to find the primitive, right? Which is to compute an area, to find the antiderivative of this function. And we discussed this. We had already this lecture 12, remember, on areas, integrals, so I bring you back to there. We would speak of differential equation when there is the function itself that appears on top of its derivative, so something like this, yeah, a function of y. And actually, there is a large body of technique that brings this type of proper differential equation to this type of simpler differential equation that can be solved only by taking the primitive. This is a so-called separable differential equation. It's when the equations are of this type. Y prime of x is equal to something of this type, where f and h are two generic, arbitrary, general type of equation. So this is separable because you see that I could break indeed or compare it with something which is non-separable, like this. I will take fgh, we'll take a third function, x and y. So remember, I don't write it, but y is a function of x here as well, huh? Even though I don't write it because this is implied, but y is a function of x. Let's use the same color, it's a function of x. So this is non-separable, provided that this is different from this. I cannot write the two variables, so uv is different, that doesn't exist, f and h, such that I can put all the variable u with one function and all the variable v with another function, okay? And most of the functions, of course, are of this type, yeah? It's just that they're not a product. Because when this is the case, this we can actually bring back to this type of equations. How? Well, we put all the variable on the one side. So all the y I put on the one side. Let me use the color for the separable case. So we've got y prime. I will keep the x for now. Doesn't matter. But divided by h of y of x is equal to f of x. Yeah. So again, we wouldn't write all the time the variable for the function y. Actually, y as a function becomes an object in itself. Yeah. So we don't have to carry on this own variable. We look at it as an object. So it becomes like this object y. Okay, so we would write it like this, equal f of x. Okay. And then we can integrate on both sides. Okay. So in which case, if we can calculate this primitive and this primitive, then that's it, because here, assuming that it can be integrated, which often is not the case, but here we'll get something which is a function of y, and here we've got something which is a function of x. Let me give you an example, because example should clarify things. This function, for instance, y prime is equal to xy squared. So if you look at it, it's not obvious, huh? It's telling us that, let's look a bit at the structure before we solve it. So there is x, there is a function of x, y of x, so it will be something. Don't know what it is so far, I will draw something which is whatever. Let's see, this is the solution. So it means this, that at any given x, for all x, the slope, yeah, the derivative of this function, is equal to the value, so the height of this function, multiplied by the x, by the parameter, squared. Yeah. So here, if this slope is equal to this times this squared, which function smoothly, continuously has this fantastic property of doing this? Well, we can find that easily because this is separable. Indeed, you see that even though we try to hide, to conceal the separability by using these kind of things, actually, you know that now you are familiar enough with algebra to know that this is y squared equal x squared. You see, we've got all the y variables, functions, all the y on the one side of the equation and on the x on the other side. Here the x doesn't count, eh, because the x is the fact that it makes the thing a function, but it's not there explicitly. This is very powerful, this separation of variables. We use it a lot to solve equations. Last lecture I'll show you how to solve the heat equations, for instance the equation for temperature in terms of Fourier series, and this idea of separation of variables. So as we said, now it's just to integrate the both sides. Okay, so if you want to make it even more clear, we could write y prime to actually completely separate or disconnect the x, the variable, from the function. We could even say that y prime is dy over dx. In which case, we've got, let's do it like this. Let's come back there, because I was very symbolic so far. We could be more clear. We could say dy over dx, that's y prime, is equal to x squared y squared. Okay? So I could even do this to separate even further the functions from its variable. I could put this dx there, and I can put that's the separation of variable, the y square. See, it's even more compelling. It's even more beautiful like this. Okay, so back to what we are doing. We can integrate on both sides. So the interest of doing this like this is that now I've got my differential, yeah, that I would have to put there. This is fine because, okay, this is the integral, this is the primitive of x squared, which we can solve right away. It's 1/3 of x cubed. Let's write it, 1/3 of x cubed plus some constant. I told you before, the constant, we tend not to put them because they, in the fundamental theorem of calculus, they just say where you start to integrate, doesn't matter too much. When we solve differential equation, on the opposite, they are crucial. Yeah, they change the character of the solution. So don't forget to put the constant there, at least on one side. And here, so this is the primitive of this thing. What is the primitive of y 1 over squared? So you should know, because, I mean, if I show you the answer, at least you recognize it right away. If we differentiate 1 over x, this is minus 1 over x squared. Yeah? If this is a function f, 1 over f, the derivative is minus f prime over f squared. So here we've got, I should have written y directly, is minus y prime over y squared for this one. Yeah, we could have done it like this. So like this, similarly, I make this little parenthesis to show you that it would have been fine to do it without introducing this Leibniz notation for derivative, dy over dx. So we have, I said, minus, we need to carry on the minus there, minus 1 over y that we integrate, fundamental theorem of calculus, so this is minus 1 over y, plus constant. I don't need to put the plus constant because I can absorb it there. Constant is whatever I want to choose. As long as it's on one side, we are good. So that gives us the solution indeed. I will put the minus on the other side. That's minus, I don't need to change the sign of the constant, because constant could have been negative, so it becomes positive constant. So our solution is y of x is equal to 1 minus 1/3, let's put it like this, would be more pretty, x cubed, and here I've got the constant. Can multiply everybody by 3, so that's 3 minus 1. Again, the constant, I don't need to carry this the over constant, because a constant multiplied by 3 is another constant, yeah, and I didn't specify which it is. Could have been maybe 1/3 from the beginning of this C. So that's the solution. So if we plot these functions, let's say that we will take C equal 0. Any C is a solution, right? So 3 divided by minus s cubed, which is something like this. It is for x, so that's minus 3 divided by s cubed. This function is such that if you take its slope, if you look at the slope there, then it is equal to the square of the height multiplied by the square of this distance. This function has this property. Was not obvious from the beginning, but by separation of the variable, we could solve it, and then we can check. So I let you check that. Do you want that we check together? And you... Okay, let's copy that, and I let you check the others that we will solve. Of course, we cannot spend all the lectures checking, but at least to... Maybe to illustrate what I mean by checking the solution. So we say that the solution, and like this, we'll see if we made a mistake. So it's 3c minus, I will keep c because I want to have all the solutions. All the solutions are there, yeah? Yeah, I don't have a constant, of course. If I have the constant there, it will break this property, clearly. So the constant is where it should be. That's why we shouldn't solve it. So how do we check? Well, we take the first order derivative. That's u over v, so that's... or 1 over u is minus u prime over u square, so it's 3 u prime over u square, c minus x3 squared, and here we've got plus, we've got 9x squared, and this is it equal to 3c minus x cubed squared, which is this term, y squared times x. Yes, it is, because we've got the 9, which is 3, we've got this square, which is there, and then we've got x squared, it should have been x squared because we got the square on the x. So this is correct. This is the good solution. Okay. I will let you look in the notes. There is a lot of cases that you can practice on and check this kind of thing. Instead, let me show you other families of other types of differential equations that have interest, like to illustrate the concept or to practice, and as well because sometimes they have some physical relevance. Like for instance, these Bernoulli equations, Bernoulli from the brother, yeah, Bernoulli, the Swiss brother. Bernoulli differential equation is a question of this type. We've got the first order derivative of our function. Then here we've got polynomial, or not even polynomial, function, whatever function, arbitrary function, which is whatever you want, that multiplies our unknown function, the one that we want to solve for, and this is equal to another arbitrary function q and the nth power of y. So it's a very particular type. Eh? The main quality of this differential equation is that we can solve it exactly using a trick that I will show you now. It has some relevance for some problem like the problem of dissipation. So we introduce dissipation already as something like this. Yeah, when the acceleration, or the force, once multiplied by the mass, is proportional to the velocity. Yeah, this velocity there. This we introduce. This is a nice type of dissipation, but it has some shortcomings or some pathology. For instance, it doesn't stop the object or the particle submitted to this type of dissipation in finite time. So we can add a term like this, another friction term of this type, like the cube, a power, non-linear power, of the velocity. And then the particle will stop in finite time. So you see this is the Bernoulli equation, where our unknown is v, here, so the prime becomes a dot, the y becomes a v. Here we've got p, which is a constant, it's not a function, and this q is also minus nu, is also a constant. And we've got n equal 3. So that's the type of Bernoulli equation which can solve exactly. But it's much more general Bernoulli equation because p and q are arbitrary functions. So you see differential equations are really a complete full extension of this concept of equations, where before we had, doing algebra for the quadratic equation, we had ABC. But ABC were also numbers, like x, the variable itself. Well, here everything is a function. The unknown is a function, and also the parameters a and b, which are called p and q there, can be functions. Yeah? So there is a nice trick to solve this, is to introduce a variable z, which is like this. Y to the power of 1 minus n. So z is a function of x, y is a function of x as well. I don't write it, but it's simple. So why this is a nice trick? Because let's compute. What is z prime? Z prime, e will be the derivative of this, so that's 1 minus n. Y prime, y 1 minus n minus 1, which is minus n. Okay? And why does it help us, this substitution? Because if I multiply my equation, my Bernoulli equation, which is there, I copy it. If I multiply it by y minus n everywhere, which I will do in a different color, so I multiply every term by y minus n, what happens is that this cancels. Yeah, it's 1. Here, I can multiply as well by 1 minus n. That would be simpler. Make a bit of room. 1 minus n, and I've got here 1 minus n. This guy here, we recognize as this one. So I can write z prime, let me come back to this color, plus 1 minus n. So this guy, I can put it with this one. So I remove it, and that's 1 minus n, which is z. Yeah? It's equal to z. So here I can put p of x, z is equal to 1 minus n, which is constant, q of x. Okay? So this is a differential equation for the variable now z, which is a function of x. Okay? But we remove this term. And this is a very general type of equation. It's called the linear equation because it is, I mean, well, I say it's called, you can see it's linear in the sense that it would be linear if this term is zero. Yeah? So actually, next lecture, I will show you how we can solve linear equation with or without this term there. So when it's like this, we call it a non-homogeneous linear equation, because it's linear except that it has a term that breaks the non-linearity. So this term is, it's not a big deal, we can deal with it. So let's assume it's not there for a while. The way to solve a non-linear equation actually is to forget this term for a while. We put it back at the end, we put a zero. And then this is linear in the sense that if I take two solutions, Z1 and Z2, that satisfy this equation. So we'll do what we did last time with the Fourier series. Yes, the same idea actually. We could solve the driven damped oscillator by using particular cases of what we are making the general theory of now. So I will copy it again. So this should be familiar from last lecture. So I've got two solutions in green and in red, Z1 and Z2. They satisfy this. So you see that now any linear superposition, linear combination of these two solutions. So I will take still a third color, alpha Z1 plus beta Z2, for any alpha beta that belongs to the scalar space, so it could be real, complex number, whatever we are dealing with, is a solution of this, right? Why? Because if I take the derivative of this, so I will copy this twice, like this. You got this in the way. Okay. So I will put this, if this is a solution, it means that this particular combination satisfies this equation. Yeah. So let us see if this is true. I will write the equation. We've got plus 1 minus 1 p of x. It should be equal to 0. Is it true? So the differentiation is linear, right? Which linear, it means that this term can go there. Okay, can go there. Then I can remove the parentheses. And of course, the product, so this is the very early algebra, the very first step we think, a, b plus c is a, b plus a, c. It means that I can break it like this. I can remove the parentheses there. Of course, if I distribute my term there. Okay, so let's do it like this. And then we can rearrange. So I can take this term there, put this one there. There is something which is trailing there, I don't know what it is, probably don't need it. So I need to put a plus there, and I can bring this over there. I did nothing, let me get rid of that. What is this? What was this thing? I don't know. I just moved it around, right? But then what do you see here? You see that this thing in yellow is exactly this. Yeah, check. Which means it is equal to zero. So here we got zero. And this thing there, check again, is exactly equal to this thing. Well, to alpha this thing and beta these things. Yeah. So this is zero. This is zero. So when I told you check, there's one thing that I could have done before, because now with all this color it might be difficult, but I could have factorized the alpha. Yes, yeah, so I have to remove this alpha there. Okay, and what is equal to zero, if I want to be accurate, is this inside. Yeah, so what is equal to the thing above is what is inside the parentheses. Alpha times zero is equal to zero. So the same for the green. I don't do it for the green, but you can factorize the beta, and then it's equal to this, equal to zero. So you see that. Let's look at it again. If Z1 is solution of the Bernoulli equation, and Z2 is solution to the Bernoulli equation, then alpha Z1 plus beta Z2 for any alpha and beta is solution, again, of the Bernoulli equation, because it works. It is inside. Yeah? It is equal to zero. Does it ring a bell, this? It shows you that Z1 and Z2 are basis vector for the function space of solution of this equation. So the solution of linear equations, they have the vector space structure. That's why linear algebra is so important. Yeah? Because not only solve problems that we have seen already, but it also it's also at the basis of things like the theory of ordinary differential linear equations. It's very important. Then we can bring all the machinery, all the eigenvalue, all the things that we have seen. Okay, so what we would do there is to specifying P and Q, try to solve this thing, and when it's solved, we have the solution for Z. We remind ourselves that Z is defined like this, and then we will get certainly strongly nonlinear functions, because we will have to take the root 1 minus nth root power of this solution to get the solution of the original equation that interests us, which was this one. So a lot of substitution, a lot of intermediate steps, but it can be solved just following the procedure. Let's look at the more general theory of how to solve this linear equations. Today we will focus on the first order, so first order derivative linear equation. And next lecture we look at the second order differential linear equations, because they are so important, the linear equations. Non-linear equations, they come on the one-to-one basis, which means that there might be a trick like this Bernoulli, there might be a technique, but most of the time, in most cases, there are no solutions. We need to turn to numerical approximation, which is a different topic. It's something we'll see next semester as part of scientific computing. So let's look at the general theory for solving this type of equation. I can divide the coefficient, which will be in front of the first order derivative, because here we'll get something, so I can divide by whatever I get. So the more general, without loss of generality, the more general type of equation is something like this. We've got x there, okay? So that's what we are going to do now, to solve this first order linear differential, ordinary differential equation. Why linear? So p can be non-linear. P can be the square root of 1 plus x squared, q as well. It's linear for y, for the reason we have just seen. Okay, so linear doesn't mean that it's ax plus b equals 0. Yeah, it's not this. Linear, it means what we have, how we have defined it, that whatever thing we are considering, we've got this procedure. That's the definition of linearity. Yeah, we can break the sum like this, and we can bring the constant outside, which was the case for the solution of this equation. Okay. So, to solve these linear equations, as I told you, it's non-homogeneous because we got this term. Yeah, we will see in the next lecture how to generalize this concept in terms of vector space. So far, I just want to show you the technique involved and how the exponential comes back to RSQ with this particular structure, this particular property. It helps us to solve this. Indeed, we are going to consider this strange-looking object, which is called the integrating factor. Is the exponential of the integral. So from some point, we don't care what it is, I will call it alpha, it doesn't matter. Here we've got x, which is our variable of the function. We put it there. And then we've got here the functions that we are we have as the coefficient of the non-differentiated unknown function. So this is P of, I have to change the variable because I cannot call it x, because the x I'm using it there. Yeah, so it becomes a dummy variable. So this thing is called an integrating factor. And why do we need to consider such an horrible thing? Because if we substitute this, if we manipulate this, because of the property of the exponential, it will allow us to transform, a bit like in this Bernoulli trick, a complicated ODE, differential equation, into something which we can integrate. So let's do it. Let's differentiate that. And we'll differentiate the integrating factor. So it looks very difficult, but because we know the algebra, we shouldn't be intimidated, and we'll see that it's quite tractable. Okay, so let's do it slowly. If you want, I take the derivative. This is a composite function. This, yeah? Composite function, remember, we have to differentiate this, composite with this function, and multiply by the derivative of the other one. So this prime here, this prime on this f is the exponential, derivative of the exponential is the exponential. That's the benefit, nothing changed. We compose it with the thing inside. So actually, that stays like this. It's easier than you suspected, I'm sure. And then you have to multiply by the derivative of the function inside, yeah? Which is this. What is the derivative of this? Fundamental theorem of calculus. Yeah. Here we don't care, this alpha will disappear. That's why we put the x there, because that will give us p of x. If you don't remember that, pause and rush to your notes or video on the, again, lecture 12. It looks like it will be the most important, pivotal, foundational lectures of this series, because I always refer to lecture 12, on primitives, on integrals, on areas, where we demonstrate that if you take the derivative of a function like this, d over dx, which is this derivative, what you get is, so here I do something very bad, which is to call x this, it has to change the name, it's dominant x, this is f of x. Remember that this disappears, it's where we start to integrate, it doesn't matter, we start there, because what we are doing is looking at the rate of change of the area, rate of change of the area is the function itself. Okay, so, why this is good to do this? Because now we are armed to do something which looks even more difficult, which is to take the derivative of the integrating factor multiplied by the functions, which is the unknown eventually. This is our unknown parameter, yeah? So we want to solve this. I will write it like this to win space and time, like this, yeah? We want to differentiate this. So how do we do that? Again, it looks complicated, but at this stage, because we already differentiated the integrating factor, this is no more difficult than to the product rule of differentiation, u prime v plus uv prime. Yeah? So u prime is y, v is the integrating factor, I will write it like this, plus u, so it was u prime, I shouldn't forget, plus u is y, and then the integrating factor, we've seen that this is, again, itself times p. Okay, so we can factorize, and here you see the value of the exponential, yeah? It stays there. It spits the coefficient, but it stays there. And that's the trick we used last time to solve this Fourier series. Do you recognize this term? Do you recognize this term there? If I zoom out, you will find it. Here, that's this term, okay? So what we get here, if I multiply by the integrating factor, let's do it, we both duplicate it. Let me try to duplicate it better without taking the parentheses. Okay, we'll duplicate it and change the style, the different color, and do that again. Okay, so I multiply both sides of this equation by this. So I put parentheses because there is a plus there. Yeah, there is a plus, which otherwise I would break the equation, yeah, so that it maintains an equality, I have to multiply everything. Okay, so let's copy that and come back to the full screen. So this quantity here, this quantity, which is this one, is by the game of equality, is this guy. Yeah? So here I can write that this is equal to y exponential the integrating to y the exponential factor, integrating factor. Like this, yeah, well, the x there. And this is equal to, by definition, to q exponential p dz. And here we did everything, because now we can formally integrate. Formally integrate, all these things are function of x. So provided that this quantity is integrable, which often is not the case, but sometimes it is, I will show you some examples, then we have the solution. We've got y, fundamental theorem of calculus, the integral of the derivative is the function itself. So it's alpha, let's write to write a bit more of the intermediate quantity. You have got the x, is equal to this integral. So we have got x exponential alpha x p of z dz, and here we've got this integral dx. Here I've been careful, huh? Doesn't look like I'm careful, but I've been careful. So this x, and this x is the same. So when we do this integral there, when we integrate like this, we are changing this x and we are changing this x. So it looks like it's a complicated quantity, huh? This is our solution. I did something I told you not to do, I didn't put the constant. Don't forget the constant. The constant is super important. Because our solution is like this. Is this guy. So I will multiply. I'll copy first and multiply. So it's q of x exponential alpha x p of z dz dx plus c. I don't care about the sign again. I put this constant on the other side. I can keep it positive. Doesn't matter. And then I multiply by this guy. So that's why the constant is important. Because this constant is multiplied by this term. And this term is clearly not something simple. Yeah, so this term is being copied there on this constant. I cannot just add plus constant at the end. The constant, like it was the case there, for instance, so it was in the denominator, remember, the constant doesn't appear where it wants. It has to appear at the precise good point of the equation so that in the differential equation, it has the good behavior. Okay, so this we can put in red box because this is a formal solution. Now we are going to apply this because this is really abstract, really general, but this is how to solve the first order linear differential ordinary equation. Lots of things. Okay, let's look at particular case. Actually, we could keep it in this form, but usually we don't do this. We compute the integrating factor separately, then we multiply it, and then we solve it. Let me give you an example. So this equation, the derivative plus y divided by x is equal to 3x. Yeah. So this is of the type y prime plus p of x y is equal to q of x, where p of x is equal to the inverse function. So I told you, it doesn't have to be linear. And q of x is a bit simpler, is 3x. But this is not linear for the variable. It is linear for the function. So we compute our integrating factor, which was like this. Now you will see how it simplifies, why actually we took this particular case to keep things simple. So our integrating factor is the exponential of x p of z, let's change the demi variable dz. So this is the exponential of dz. This is the dz over dz, alpha x, and this is what is the primitive of 1 over, what am I writing? dz over z. dz over z. What is the primitive of 1 over z? This is the logarithm, called exponential of the logarithm, what happened? Of the logarithm of x, come back to x, and this is ax. So an integrating factor is very simple in this case. It is simply x, even that it arrives as the exponential of some primitive. Okay, so what do we do now? We multiply. So if we multiply the left-hand side of our equation, if we multiply the left-hand side of the equation by the integrating factor, we get, because this is equal to the right-hand side, we get the right-hand side times the integrating factor. And this is equal, so the right-hand side times the integrating factor is equal to the unknown times the integrating factor. Okay? So, let's take q times the integrating factor, which is x in our case. So q was equal to 3x. So that makes 3x squared is equal to the derivative of y times the integrating factor. So that's the equation which we should get. And this is easy to solve by... we will take the integral of both sides, so we take the primitive. So we got y x, primitive of this fundamental theorem of calculus, is equal to the primitive of 3x squared, which is, what is the primitive of 3x squared? This is x cubed, simply. And we need a plus constant somewhere. Let's not forget the plus constant. Okay, so that's the solution. Very simple one. I bring the x on the other side. It's x2 plus c divided by x. Again, you see that the constant was important not to forget because it brings this particular case. It wouldn't have been wrong to forget it. We would just have avoided or lost most of the solution, the one that involved this one, this singularity, because this is the solution. Yeah. Okay, so we can check again. I said we wouldn't check, but let's do it very quickly, because there it's a second order. It was a first order. What is the equation that we started with? This is this one. Okay, I let you check this one. It's easy. Yeah, so substitute there your solution, and it should give you this. Let's look at a different example, something which is a bit more involved, because maybe you are completely confused or lost or intimidated, but actually, it's fairly simple. Let's look at a case which looks more complicated, more interesting, and that will solve with this method of integrating factor. It will involve trigonometric function. So we will solve this one, cos x, and I let you contemplate it for a while and tell me if you think that this is something you would feel able to tackle. This is a differential equation that we are going to solve. Minus 1. Yeah. Write it better. The main difficulty would be not to drop a sign or forget something because we are writing so fast and so lazily and so badly. So look at this. Y, again, remember, y is a function of x, right? So we want the function that if we take the derivative multiplied by the cos, and we add to this the height of the function multiplied by the sine is equal to this very complicated, very ugly looking right hand side. How would you do that? It looks super difficult, right? Actually, I showed you how to do it. So we will divide everybody by the cos to have y prime plus p of x. The method I gave you, there was nothing there. It's what I told you, it's easy because you can divide by the prefactor. So sine divided by cosine is the tangent of x, and we've got y is equal to q of x. So our q of x would be equal to 2 cos square x, simplifies a bit there, minus sec of x. Where here I use this notation that the sec is the inverse cos, the secant. Okay, so we have to compute the integrating factor, which was, you remember, the exponential of the primitive of this p term. This exponential of the p, here is the tangent, z dz. We need the primitive of the tangent. What is the primitive of the tangent? It's something that is the example I gave you in the lecture, famous lecture 12, of formulas that once we see this formula, then we pay attention to it because it looks like it's a useful thing to remember. Tangent is an important fundamental function, so it's nice to remember what is the thing. This is the primitive of the tangent is the logarithm of the cos. Let's check if I remember correctly. Yeah? So logarithm of the cos, we use again this composition of function. Well, we've got f equal to the logarithm, g is equal to the cos. So what do we get there? If we differentiate this, does it give us the tangent? Looks like it's not true, huh? Let's look at this. Okay, so f prime is the inverse. G is the cos, g prime, derivative of the cos, is the sine. So we are missing the sine. Because this is the sine and this is minus tangent. Yeah, tangent is sinus divided by cosine. We are missing the sine. Okay, that's like this. Therefore, this is exponential minus logarithm of the cosine. And this is 1 over the exponential of the logarithm. It is the cosine. So that's the sec. Our integrating function is the sec. Let's try. We multiply y by the integrating factor, which is the sec. The derivative of this should give us sec of x. Should give us the right-hand side, which was here, times the integrating factor. Times the integrating factor, which is the sec. So there is a square here, and the sec is the inverse cos, so we simplify this cos there. Okay? So we could check, we could take the derivative of this product rule and check that we recover our initial differential equation. But let's integrate instead. So we've got y sec of x is equal to the primitive of cos x sine x. So actually, 2 sine x cos x, we know from last lecture that this is sine 2x. And then we've got, by linearity, the integral of the sec square. Whoa, the integral of the sec square. It looks a nasty one, yeah? But sec square is 1 over cos square. And 1 over cos square, it's also something that actually has a nice primitive, which is the tangent. Let's look at the tangent. If we differentiate the tangent, so it's sine divided by cos. The derivative of a quotient, so it's u over v, it's u prime v minus uv prime divided by v square. U prime is the derivative of the sine is cos v square minus u sine v prime derivative of the cos is plus sine Pythagoras, this is equal to 1 divided by cos square. Okay, yeah, I'm using Pythagoras. cos square plus sin square is equal to 1. Okay, so fundamental theorem of calculus, if the derivative of tangent is 1 over cos, the primitive of 1 over cos is the tangent. Okay, so it was no big deal. Here we get the primitive of sine of 2x is minus cos 2x, right? If I differentiate this, I get this. And here we just did it, it's minus tangent x. So we got our solution. Don't forget, I'm not forgetting so that I can say don't forget and you get the point. Well, at least I remember to put it back when I need to. Don't forget to put this constant. So now we've got the solution. The solution is, I can put everything on the same side. So we've got y of x is equal to minus 1 half cos 2x. The inverse of sec of the second is the cosine. So we've got cos 2x cos x. Minus the tangent sine over cos multiplied by cos, the inverse of the sec, which is coming from the other side, is the sine of x. And then we got plus c, I don't care about the sine as well, but I care about multiplying by the cos. So that's our general solution. It's highly non-trivial, huh? Couldn't have guessed. Sometimes you will see that differential equation, you can guess more or less. We can see what it is, we try and balter. I think it would have been difficult to guess that, especially because we are mixing here the... This is fine, but linearity maybe we could get there, but here we are mixing the cos 2x with the cos x, this type of thing. So this time I need to check really that if you insert this solution into this differential equation, which was at the beginning, you will find the thing. I let you check this by the algebra. I want to see with you the confirmation of this, that we will check that with the computer, which means that we will have the chance as well to start the computer. I know it's a very old computer, it makes lots of noise. Okay, okay, it is there, you've got it, you see it with me. We will look at the meaning of this thing. So I will copy again the equation, we have the solution, and we are going to check together that it works in terms of plotted solutions. Yeah, I told you, because we are looking at equations of functions, our solutions are functions, we can plot these functions. Okay, so this is the equations here, and this is the solutions. So what it says is that if I take this function, that I will do this first thing, I will plot this function. We will plot this function. This is what you see me doing on the screen, like this. Okay, so we said this is minus 1 half. We just have to hope that we didn't make a mistake, because if there's a mistake, it will not work, of course, and it will be embarrassing. Okay, then we got minus sine x, I'm copying over here, and then we got a constant. So it's maybe it's not very important, this thing. I'll still put the constant here, we'll call it A, big A. Because x is used variable. Okay, and we will plot this between these trigonometry, so some several circles of the trigonometric circle. We have to define the function, so this function I will let it change. We have to define the constant if you want to plot. Yeah, so I will say that I will let it run between minus 1 and 1. So that's a solution. Yeah, so all these are solutions. If I change a, I'm changing the type of my thing, right? That is nice because it has a good swing to it, so let's allow it to change more, this constant. Yeah. Okay, so all these are solutions. In which sense this is solutions? So it is a solution in the sense that if I put this in this equation, so to do that I need to compute the derivative, which is very easy to do. Formally, the computer is very good at doing so-called... This is not numerical calculation. This is not the type of numerical computation we'll do next semester. This is formal numerical calculation, and this is something you will see much later on or on your own. So I'm taking the differentiation, and this is giving me this expression. So this is the derivative. I will plot this as well there. So in blue is our function, and as computed by the computer, you can check that in orange or in yellow we got the derivative. So first we can check that this is the K. I mean, you are not more stupid than the computer. You see that the one that comes with the A, for instance, the derivative of the cos, he took minus sign. The way it does is by replacement and substitution. Differentiation is easy, so you can do that easily. So you apply the rules, you can check that, and you can obtain this result yourself. You get this thing. So let's check first that we agree with the meaning. Remember, this is function and this is derivative. When the derivative is zero, what happens? We reach an extremum. The function is horizontal. Is it the case? Here is zero, you see that this is horizontal. Here is zero, this is horizontal. Zero, for the derivative is zero, horizontal. Zero, horizontal. So it works, it finds the good extrema. We said that when the derivative is positive, the function increases. You see that here is positive from there, and indeed it increases. It increases until this point, where it's horizontal, and then the derivative becomes negative, and it goes down. So on and so forth. The higher is the derivative, the steeper is the function. When the derivative is close to zero, the function goes like this. This we discussed already, When we describe derivative, we explain this kind of thing. We could take the second order derivative, this I will leave for next lecture. So now the statement is that if I take the function, which is there, and I multiply it by the sine of x. And I add to this the derivative of the function, which is this one. And I multiply the derivative of the function by the cosine of x. This would be equal to this right-hand side, to these things. So I need also to plot the right-hand side. I will plot the right-hand side there. So this one doesn't depend on the constant, of course, because that's part of the equation. So this will stay what it is, sine of x minus 1. So now I've got three curves. 2 cos cube sine x minus 1. Very good. Okay, so if I change a, the green will stay the same because it's part of the function, but you see that both the function, of course, its derivative is changing. They're changing on a. There, for instance, we've got a lot of zeros, so a lot of stationary point. Very good. So let's look at this particular combination. I will add this fourth function, which I think will appear in red. And this fourth function should fall on the green. And it doesn't, which means that we made a mistake somewhere. We'll try to catch the mistake now. Almost. And what is missing is a sign. Because I'm missing the sign there. You see there's a sign there. There's a sign there that I didn't have in my equations. I copied it wrong. Okay. So now I'm changing a bit. I made a mistake there as well, then therefore missing the sign there. So we are losing a bit of time. I'm sorry, but most of what we said is still valid. We just have to copy again the derivative. We have to put it in the derivative, which was the one I was coming with the cos. The cos is there, so that's my derivative. There. And this time, it's a bit better, but it's still not correct, so there's still a mistake. Okay, E as well, because I forgot it there as well. Okay, and this one is working. So to convince you that the red and the green are on top of each other, maybe I can displace a bit more the green. So instead of displacing by minus 1, I will not displace it, so it will be centered, it will be larger by 1. Okay? But like this you see that if I displace it, they are together. So for all the possible A, so here we have all the solutions. When I change A, you see that all the blue, the solutions are the blue. All the blue satisfy the thing that, so now we can look at the meaning of this, let me increase that. So what we get is that, at this point, minus 2, the value of the function, which is there, I'll use 2, one for the math, the other for the thing. So the value of the function, which is like multiplied by the sign of x, by the sign at these things. We can as well, let me do that, Let me plot the sine and cosine. Sine of x, it will be a lot of curves. But we can, what's happening? Sine of x and cos of x. Because the parameter, the coefficients of the function, which is alpha and beta or A and B in a quadratic equation, which are P and Q there, they are functions of X, so they can vary as well. So we are plotting them. So you see lots of different things. Okay, so I zoom that, and we look. So, at a given value, at 2, the value of Y multiplied by the sign, which is the value of the purple there, plus the slope of the blue, which is this value. It's negative because the function is going down. So, plus this value multiplied by the cosine, which is this one. The cosine is this brown. This is equal to the red, this value, which is 2 cos cube sine x minus 1. So 2 cos cube sine x is the purple. I took a point where all the shapes are degenerate. So let's take this one, which is 2. This is 3, 2.5. Let's put a grid line of 2.5 if you want. Very quickly. So 2.5. Don't want green lines there. Okay, and we look at this point. So the blue y here, this value multiplied by the sign, which is the purple, multiplied by this value, plus the slope of the blue, which is this value there, the yellow. It's positive because now we are increasing. Multiplied by the cosine, which is the red. So you make this product of the red with the yellow, and you add to this the product of the blue with the purple. This will be equal to the cube of the cos, which is the cube of this value, multiplied by the sine of by the sine, which is this value. So the cube of this multiplied by this times 2 minus 1, so that gives us the red, is equal to the other thing. Both of them are equal for this particular thing. You can do it, and you can read these values, make the product, take the cube, do all the possible thing, add them, and you will see that these combinations work. It works. It works for this grid line, but it works everywhere. And you see that it's kind of magic, yeah, because this balance of the derivative and the function weighted by this time, well, by this varying coefficients, they agree everywhere. They are matched everywhere. And here, in essence, you've got this concept of differential equation. It's an equation like the one we started with, quadratic equation, where the one parameter is upgraded to the variable. It makes a lot of glare in my glasses. Yeah, you think it is the computer that does this? Is it? I mean, not completely. It is this one. I don't know. Well, there is something I should be looking. You see, like in the movies, you can guess. You can read my bank account from the reflection in my glasses or something. What is reflecting in my glasses? Anyway, what was I saying? So that's the concept of differential equation. Yeah, where we've got this perfect balance for all the possible things. So whenever you got to differential equation, the mind is invited to consider, to see what's happening. Are the things multiply and balance each other like this to finally get the good answer? It's more interesting when the differential equation corresponds to physical. You think if I remove the glasses, you will solve this problem? Now I can look here. Yeah? People without glasses have a lot of advantages. It's really unfair. Really unfair that I got these troubles. What was I saying? We are not very focused today. Yeah, when we are doing physics, it's really... Do I look weird without the glasses? When we are doing physics, it's really important. It's really nice to try to interpret, to understand what the terms mean physically, and how is it balanced by the other terms, and how all this combination leads to some phenomena, some phenomenology that corresponds to describing something which happens in the real world. That's what physics is about. It's interpreting the equations. And when there are different equations, we are seeing how rate of change multiplied by a weight or a force is giving rise to some pressure or some movement, acceleration, speed, whatever. Depending on the equation, we've got different interpretation, of course. That's what makes physics interesting, the interpretation of the equation, not the techniques to solve them. But you understand that before you get to interpret the equations, of course, you should be able to deal with them, to understand what they mean, how they work, and have at least some rudimentary or some idea, illustration, some knowledge, some taste, some experience of how to solve them. Next lecture, we come back to the same thing. but with the second order differential equation, and that will allow us as well to come back to this now I hope favorite notions of vector space, of linearity, and when we get the basis of things, when we got the basis, well, basically we've got everything.